You remember that movie Happy Feet with the penguin? That's sort of how I felt this morning. I'm tapping my feet. Thank you for putting us in the mood and getting us in the spirit.
Heartiest greetings of joy in Jesus Christ.
Heartiest greetings of joy in Jesus Christ. I'm Reverend Candace.
I'm Ken Winkleman, one of the lay leaders here at Desert Skies.
And we welcome you to Desert Skies United Methodist Church. We are a joyful community drawing people to Christ, a multi-site ministry. We're one church, two campuses, and online. So if you're worshiping with us for the first time this morning, either on site or online, we are so glad that you're here.
For those of you on site, please fill out the connection card on the back flap of your bulletin. For those of you online, it's at the top of your screen. There is a space for you to put prayer requests and to inquire about for more information. We thank you for trusting us with your information.
As you can see, our technological challenges continue, and so I will remind you that this is a bulletin, and all of the responses that you will need are on the bulletin. Those of you who are worshiping online, you have the full effect of the service. Maybe that's why they're all worshiping online.
Could be.
Maybe. But I do know that several of our congregation members are called in sick this morning, and so we continue to lift them in prayer. But you will need your bulletin. You'll need your hymnals to follow along in the service this morning. So the page numbers and everything are here for our hymns, and so we encourage you to do that old-time religion. If you are really screen-deprived, you can sign up to be a liturgist because this screen works. Or you can sing in the choir, amen? Okay, because their screen works as well. But encourage you to worship fully despite those technological glitches. You'll notice that you have a special offering envelope in your bulletin this morning. This is one of the six special Sundays for the United Methodist Church. This is for Human Relations Day, as we help people around the world and in our own communities to have a leg up so that they might live life abundantly as we do. So in today's scripture text, we are going to learn and read again the story of a wedding at Cana and the turning of water into wine. That shows us that God's covenant is all about abundant life. And that then our discipleship compels us to share this river of God's delight with others. You see, wine is meant for sharing, and God's glory is revealed in Christ as he blesses the community with abundance and joy. That enables us to see Jesus in new and wondrous ways. Let's enter into our time of worship.
Good morning. I'm Fred Pascoe, and I'm your liturgist today. Please stand with me for our call to worship. We gather today with a new song in our mouth.
A song of freedom and worship.
We gather today with feet set on solid rock.
A rock of justice and peace.
We gather today to praise God for wondrous deeds.
We delight to do God's will with God's law within our hearts.
Please be seated.
Thank you.
gift giver. You call us together with our different gifts, our different ideas, our different tastes. You call us together to share what makes us special, to build each other up, to serve each other in love. You call us together, knowing that we need all parts of the body if we are to be whole. You sing us together, you call us together to sing, to pray, to listen, to speak, to be refreshed so that we can go out and serve. You call us together in the name of the one who is unveiled to us each and every day. Amen. Please be seated.
I don't see any children in the congregation, but I do know that we have some watching online, and so we're going to go ahead and have our story for all ages. I think I'm supposed to sit down here. So, Nikki, do you have Luke and Patrick online? You do. All right. So Luke and Patrick, you're on Zoom, and it's really good to see you this morning. I know Agnes comes on each week, and to all the other children who might be watching, it's so good to be part of you today. So today I want to think a little bit about how we can be helpful. What are things that we do that are helpful to other people? And when I talk to other children about this, they say things like, well, I make my bed, I pick up my toys, I help mom or dad wash the dishes. And those are really, really important things. But I think, too, that we all have ways of making people feel special, maybe by some of the gifts that we share with others. And so I have this picture that has been on my desk since Agnes drew it for me during church. She drew this picture of me and her. And that is a gift that has made my heart sing ever since the first day she did it. And so, children, I want to encourage you to use your gifts. Maybe you like to sing silly songs, or you like to do paintings or drawings, or maybe you like to read so you could read out loud to a younger child or to your grandma or grandpa or to your parents. Or maybe you like to plant flowers and grow them, but whatever it is that you can give from your heart that you like to do, that you do well, I encourage you to share those because it might mean more to you than you think. This past Christmas, my girls, I have three daughters, they gave me this special mug with this picture that shows someone with gray hair with like the backs of their, how they would look, all sitting together. This I use to hold pens and all sorts of things. It's too small for me for a coffee cup. But I use it regularly to hold things, just like their giving it to me was a gift that showed me how much they love me. So I encourage you this week to bless people in your life with your special gifts. Because in our story today, we're going to find out how Jesus, he shared a special gift with the people in his community that helped make them feel happy. And I know that you children have those kind of gifts to share as well. So let's pray together. Loving and gracious God, you give each one of us a special gift. Lots of special gifts that can help others feel really good. And so we would ask that we might be able to take what we love to do and share it with others so that they might be as happy as we are. Thank you for the children of this church, for the gifts they bring and the love they share. Amen. All right.
Hear these words from the Gospel of John, chapter 2. 3 days later, there was a wedding in the village of Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there. Jesus and his disciples were guests also. When they started running low on wine at the wedding banquet, Jesus' mother told him, "They're just about out of wine." Jesus said, "Is that any of our business, mother, yours or mine? This isn't my time. Don't push me." So she went ahead anyway, telling the servants, "Whatever he tells you, do it." 6 stoneware water pots were there, used by the Jews for ritual washings. Each held 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus ordered the servants, "Fill the pots with water," and they filled them to the brim. "Now fill your pitchers and take them to the host," Jesus said, and they did. When the host tasted the water that had become wine, he didn't know what had just happened, but the servants, of course, knew. He called out to the bridegroom, "Everybody I know brings out their finest wines, and after the guests have had their fill, brings out the cheap stuff. But you've saved the best till now." This act in Cana of Galilee was the first sign Jesus gave, the first glimpse of his glory. And his disciples believed in him. Listen, hear what the church, the Spirit, is saying to the church. We open our hearts to God.
I recently watched a movie that I hadn't heard of when it first came out. It was called Promised Land, starring Matt Damon. Did anyone see that movie? I highly recommend it if you haven't seen it. It is a movie that sort of peels back all the glamour and allure of large amounts of money from huge energy corporations drilling for natural gas, engaging in a practice you may have heard of called fracking. And fracking in this particular community offered the promise of making individuals in a very impoverished community making individuals and families rich, maybe with the promise of making them very rich millionaires. But there was also the possibility of releasing chemicals into the soil and groundwater, hastening the death of those very same struggling communities. Now, there were no quick, easy answers offered in the film, But it did remind us of the great promise that this land called America holds for all 333,987,717 of us as of today. And we're also reminded that there are promises unfulfilled, maybe even dashed hopes and shattered dreams. And reading the second chapter of John's gospel, when Jesus is at a wedding feast in Cana of Galilee, we see here not only great promise, but promises unfulfilled, some dashed hopes, potential of shattered dreams. So we see a young couple who are starting out at a high moment in their life. They're starting out together with great joy, but joy maybe becomes a little bit elusive as a problem soon develops. There is a shortage, a running out of wine. Now, not only was that a social embarrassment, it was a symbol and sign of what was yet to come. For a wedding to run out of wine was an omen that there was little chance of this particular marriage reaching its full potential. Promises barely made, but already promises unfulfilled, dashed hopes, and shattered dreams. Now, when we think of Jesus' miracles, we usually think of him helping those in desperate need, feeding the hungry, healing the blind and the lame, delivering the demon-possessed, or even raising the dead. And those account for most of the miracles that are narrated in the gospel. They are acts which relieve suffering, which restore life and health and wholeness. So perhaps it's a bit surprising then that the very first miracle of Jesus's ministry in John's gospel is one that appears almost frivolous. I mean, there is no desperate, life-threatening need in this story, no crisis of hunger or illness. Rather, the crisis in this story is that the wine has run out in the wedding banquet. It's a problem, though, that threatens to cut a wedding celebration short and to cause considerable embarrassment to the hosts, but it certainly poses no immediate danger to anyone's life or health. And when Jesus's mother tells him about the situation, Jesus himself seems to dismiss it at first as not worthy about his concern. One translation says, "Woman." Anyone else think that's a little bit presumptuous from a son? But anyway, "Woman, what concern is that to you and to me? My hour has not yet come." Now, the hour of which Jesus speaks in John's gospel is the event of his death, resurrection, and ascension to the Father. So certainly, Jesus has much more important things to worry about than a shortage of wine. But his mother seems to know better, as mothers often do. Still, our question remains. Why such an extravagant miracle? What might it have to do with addressing and repairing promises unfulfilled, dashed hopes, shattered dreams? In fact, John doesn't actually call this a miracle, but a sign. It's the first of seven such signs in John's gospel. And signs, they point us to something beyond themselves, as road signs to alert us that something lies ahead of us or before us. So the sign of Jesus changing water into wine at the Cana wedding points us to something far more valuable than the wine itself, as fine as that wine may be. It points us to the source of all life and joy. Jesus' extravagant miracle of changing the water into a wine is a sign that in him, life, joy, and salvation has arrived. At the beginning of John's gospel, the narrator told us that in him was life, and that life was the light of all people. And later in the gospel, Jesus will say himself, "I have come that they might have life and have it abundantly." You see, abundant life is more than mere existence or survival. It's certainly more than an abundance of material things. Abundant life is to know and be known by the one through whom all life came into being. Settle with that for just a minute. It's to follow the one who loves us so much that he doesn't know how to stop giving. It's the kind of life depicted by the abundance of fine wine in this story. We know that abundant life doesn't mean a life of ease, of comfort, of luxury, or even an absence of suffering or sorrow. But it does mean that in Jesus we have abundant, extravagant source of grace to sustain us. Grace that is more than sufficient to provide when we fall short and to give us joy even amid sorrow and suffering. Abundant life means that in Christ, we are joined to the source of true life, life that is rich and full and eternal, life that neither sorrow nor suffering nor death itself can destroy. As we stand this week, I think, on a cliff, perhaps of a critical moment in the life of our nation. We're celebrating Martin Luther King Jr. Day tomorrow. And then the following week, we will receive the 2022 State of the Union Address, which will be given to us by our 46th President of the United States. There are some that already view that promises are broken and unfulfilled, that there are dashed hopes, that there are shattered dreams, that there is much in the world today that is unknown and uncertain. So as Christians, what do we do when we find ourselves at the edge of the cliff? Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said, "Our goal as Christians is to create a beloved community, and this will require a qualitative change in our souls as well as a quantitative change in our lives." And wouldn't you all say that the last 2 years have seen both a qualitative change in our souls as well as a quantitative change in our lives? Because life just threw us this curveball of a pandemic. There is revolution brewing in the economy, in politics, in technology, in the runaway climate, and in the relationship between human beings and the very work that we do. And the eye of the 21st century made hard landfall in March of 2020. And frankly, it seems to be relentless in its capacity for disruption. And given how different everything looks today, millions of folks are taking a deep re-examination of their lives and rethinking it in terms of this new moment and hopefully the gifts that they bring to this moment. Because the greatest advancements in science, in medicine, in political policies, in economic growth, they all have in common an element of rethinking amidst the unknown. We find that information often brings leaders to a precipice, a decisive movement in time and place. But it has always been some unseen force, some yielding to that which lies beyond the provable and the knowable, that has enabled history's greatest leaders to take that last step forward into new and uncharted territory. It seems that we like the status quo. We like what's comfortable, what's known, what has always worked. And it's not until we are driven to the edge and sometimes pushed off that we're willing to step into that which is new and uncomfortable and challenges who we are, what we've always thought, and who we've always been. I mean, everyone told the American colonists that they could never win a victory and freedom from English rule. But on trust, they staged their seemingly impossible revolution. And everyone told Lewis and Clark they would never find their way through the uncharted Western wilderness. But on trust, they journeyed to the Pacific coast and back again. Everyone told you what? What do you tend to do when you find yourself at the edge of a cliff with your back against the wall, perhaps even crying out in despair? And how do you step forward when all those voices from your past are telling you something different about yourself? As we dream what we can be in 2022 as individuals, as a church, as community, as a nation, knowing all that we have been through in the past and guided by visionaries like Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., whom we celebrate this weekend, like Archbishop Desmond Tutu, whom we recently lost, we need to ask ourselves, can we trust Jesus enough to do whatever he asks us to do? Can we trust Jesus enough to open our eyes and our ears and our hearts to ideas never before dreamed about? We don't know what promises and plans are left unfulfilled in the lives of all those around us, our neighbors, our acquaintances, even our fellow church members, our brothers and sisters in Christ. But we know that we can begin to give hope by blessing them in small and simple ways. So I challenge us this week to intentionally bless three people in unique ways. At least one person who is not part of your church community. And then write down or tell someone in your small group or at choir or your church community or when you meet someone for coffee about the experience that you have done with someone else. You know, right now, it may seem as we look around us that we're running low on courage and vision and leadership. But we actually have amazing leadership that is emerging right in our midst. When Jesus took charge of that wedding feast and turned water into wine, the chief steward of that feast said, "Usually the good is served first, but you have saved the best for the last." And friends, we can never lose sight of that. Though we know the reality of promises unfulfilled, of dashed hopes, of shattered dreams, the best can be yet to come. May it be so for you, for me, for this church, I pray. Won't you pray with me? O God, all your people are your beloved. Across races, nationalities, religions, sexual orientations, and all the ways we are distinctive from one another, we are all manifestations of your image, and we are bound together in an inescapable network of mutuality and tied to a single garment of destiny. You call us into your unending work of justice, peace, and love. Let us know your presence among us now. Let us delight in our diversity that offers glimpses of the mosaic of your beauty. Strengthen us with your steadfast love and transform our despairing fatigue into hope-filled action. Under the shadow of your wings in this hour, may we find rest and strength, renewal and hope. We ask this, inspired by the example of those who have gone before us, and in Jesus' name, amen. I invite us now into our time of community prayer and response.
Join us in our responsive prayer. God of wedding parties and new wine, of love and laughter, dancing and singing, we pause to pray for those among your worldwide family who today may be feeling left out in the cold.
Bless the many people who must toil for such long hours that there is no time or energy to laugh or sing. Bless your children who feel so demeaned and exploited that they view even angels of mercy with suspicion and fear. Bless the many folk who are caught in vicious circles of evil and can see no way to escape.
Bless those among your children whose every waking hour is spent in pain and whose sleep is at the best fitful.
Bless those people who are drawn to Christ and new life, yet who fear the scorn of family, friends, or workmates. Bless your children who once tasted the new wine of Christ, but have now slipped away into indifference or maybe despair. Bless those folk who, with much trembling, hand their lives over to you this day. May they find faith and courage for the days to come.
Bless the people of your church that abundant love may flow in our prayers and our prayers flow into generous words and deeds.
And now for those in our hearts, we lift their names aloud, beginning with prayers for Noah Luzinski, who has been recovering from what they're calling a perforated appendix. He is still at Banner Hospital, and we pray for his recovery. We pray for Walt Mosier, who remains at TMC, and for Marion as she is supporting and caring for him as she can. We pray for Diane Ellison, who is recovering from her surgery. We pray for those in Tonga who are suffering the effects of a volcanic eruption, and for those who live along the shorelines across the world who have tsunami warnings to deal with. We also pray for rising COVID cases wherever they are rising, for those who are dealing with illness and quarantine and loneliness and isolation. And we lift up those other names now who are on our hearts today. For those we have lifted up, for those who are on our hearts, we pray in the name of the Christ who makes all things new. Amen.
God comes to us.
Across the United Methodist Connection, we come together to help bridge the gap between church and community by participating in an offering set aside for Human Relations Day. For more than half a century, United Methodists have observed this church-wide special Sunday in recognition of the message Jesus demonstrated during his life. All of God's children are important. Brothers and sisters, who we are and yet becoming as individuals shows God's presence in the world. That divine presence is reflected even more fully, powerfully, and transformatively as we unite in beloved community. Let us bring ourselves, our gifts, and our resources together that God may be glorified. If you're worshiping with us online, you may click on the donate button at the top of your screen or visit our website to give to the work of ministry here at Desert Skies. For those on site, our ushers will now come forward to receive our morning offering. Sometimes we believe the gifts we offer do not matter, but when they are combined with all the other gifts of healing, of hope, of compassion, of your heart, they can become rivers of grace and justice flowing through the lives of everyone around us. We offer our gifts to you in this hope as we pray in Jesus' name as he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation.
As we get ready to go into the world to bless it with the gifts that each of us possess, there are a few ways that we have helped make that possible right here at the church. The first, you have a flyer in your bulletin. One of our circles, the Esther Circle that meets out in Vail, is collecting winter clothes for the inn, which is a United Methodist project housed out of First Church in Tucson. And they need coats, hats, gloves, gently used or okay, just clean them before you bring them. Especially small sizes they are asking for. The adults that come across the border are actually quite small, and so we have lots of big clothes. Don't know what that says about the abundance of us in America, but if you would help us, we'll be collecting them the next two Sundays on the 23rd and the 30th, and there will be receptacles out there for you to place them. We continue our religion and science study, and I have to tell you, it is so much fun having these discussions around religion and science and faith, and we invite you to join us. You don't have to have had the first 2 weeks. If you'd like to do that, we need to send you a participant's guide, so let me know, and I'd be happy to do that. But they are just delightful discussions about things that are going on in our world, even today. Mimi has notified me that the next few weeks of altar flowers are vacant. So if you've been thinking about providing flowers for our altar, we encourage you to sign up outside on the patio after worship this morning. And as always, we will have a Stephen minister back by the Stephen, there's the Stephen Ministry banner. If you need to pray or just talk through some things with somebody, there will be somebody there after worship today. And now let's receive the benediction. God sends us out to the lonely, the forsaken, and we will go to gather them up into the heart of love. Jesus sends us out to throw a party for those who nibble at the stale crusts offered by the world, and we will go to sit with those who have no family, to fill their lives with hope and grace. The Spirit sends us forth as transformed people, as those who have been given new names, and we will go to those sunk deep in the muck of life who long for new days, for new joy, for new wonder. Amen. We did just get word. Many of you know Chuck and Sandra McNary. We just got word that Chuck McNary has entered into hospice. And so we would just ask you to keep both of them in your prayers, that it is a gentle and peaceful passing, and that they can enjoy the last time in life that they have together. And so now I invite us to sing together with upraised hands or a wave or whatever connects you to those in our community as we sing our community song of Shalom. Thank you.
Thank you.